the Israelites were living in captivity in foreign nations. One of these countries was Babylon. The king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, was troubled by a dream he had and did not understand. And he could no longer sleep because of it. So he summoned anyone he thought could interpret his dream, magicians, sorcerers, and astrologers. They arrived before the king and asked him to tell them his dream so that they could interpret it. But the king would not tell them the dream. Instead, he asked the men to tell him what the dream was and what it meant. If they were unable to, he said, they would be killed. The men answered, "There is no one on earth who can do what the king asks." King Nebuchadnezzar was furious, so he ordered the execution of all of the wise men, the magicians, sorcerers, and astrologers living in Babylon. Guards were sent to look for one of the king's servants, an Israelite named Daniel, because he too was considered one of the wise men. Daniel wisely asked the commander of the king's guard for additional time to interpret the dream. Daniel went home and together with his friends prayed that God would help them interpret the king's dream. During the night, Daniel had a vision that revealed what the king's dream was and what it meant. When he awoke, Daniel praised God and went to speak to the commander of the king's guard. "Do not execute the wise men of Babylon," Daniel requested. "Take me to the king and I will interpret his dream for him." When Daniel arrived, the king asked, "Are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it?" Daniel replied, "No wise man can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries." Then Daniel described the exact details of the king's dream. He described a giant statue made of gold, silver, bronze, and iron. Daniel described how a rock struck the statue and smashed it to pieces. Then the wind swept up all the pieces of the statue and blew them away. But the rock that had struck the statue remained and grew into a huge mountain that filled the entire earth. Then Daniel told the king what the dream meant, sharing that the different parts of the statue represented the kingdom of Babylon and other kingdoms like it. And the rock that destroyed the statue represented God's kingdom, a kingdom that would never be destroyed. At this, King Nebuchadnezzar fell down before Daniel. "Surely your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of mysteries, for you are able to reveal this mystery." Then the king made Daniel the ruler of all of Babylon, gave him many gifts, and appointed Daniel's friends to help him oversee Babylon.
Requested that we'll get engaged in our worship today. Next Sunday is the Sunday right before Christmas, so it is our Christmas musical that our adults have been working on for about 3 months. We hope you'll come and join us for that. Next Sunday, if you arrive at 9:15, you'll be late. Okay, please note changes in times for next Sunday. We have 3 services, but not on Sunday. 2 services on Sunday morning, 1 service on Saturday night before, all right? So if you kind of tend to come to 8 o'clock, don't come to 8 o'clock next week, you'll be alone, all right? But you're meeting at 7 o'clock on Saturday night. So 7 o'clock, 9 a.m., and 10:45 a.m. Those are our 3 Christmas services next weekend. There are some invitations on the table in the foyer. You may pick up some of those, give to neighbors or relatives or coworkers, invite them to be at church with us. It also has our Christmas Eve service on there. You remember last week I asked you, do you know what Christmas Eve is? What's the reason, all right? Because on that card, it says our Christmas Eve service is December 25th. That is not correct. Our Christmas Eve service will be Christmas Eve, all right? Until the 24th. So if you give that to somebody, tell them, Christmas Eve, all right? And that's 9 p.m. on Christmas Eve night. We meet for an hour. We have a grand time. Hope you'll come and join us, all right? Please note the times changes for office being open the last 2 weeks of the year and the fact that we do not have Wednesday night activities the last 2 Wednesday nights of the year here. So please take note of some of the changes for the remainder of the year. Our men's Thursday morning Bible study is going to kick off a new study at the beginning of the new year on January the 8th. I believe it's the second Thursday. We're kicking off a new study called All In, the book that many of you have been buying. We are going to do is a men's Thursday morning Bible study. It starts at 6 a.m. and ends at 6:45. Very precise. We never go over. And some of you say, yeah, sure. No, yes, men, Thursday mornings, we never go over because men have to get to work. And so we want to honor their time. And the men who are now retired need to be home by 7 to go back to bed. So we try to accommodate for both groups. All right? So. Men, it's a great way to meet other men in the church. We have a good time while we're there on Thursday morning, so come and join us if you would, please. There's some thank yous in there. Please take note of those. Let me highlight a couple of prayer requests. The Redding family, Golf Redding, was a business owner here in town. Passed away, and his service will be here on Tuesday. And then Brenda Boyer, her service is tomorrow. So if you remember the Boyer family and the Redding family, they would appreciate it. Naomi Millar continues to be under hospice care. Please continue to pray for her. She's 94. Erin Stonehouse, I saw her again this week. She's 34, under hospice care. And I had a great, great visit with her this week, but continue to remember both of them. And then Teresa Stevens, the friend of Margot York, who had just been coming for a month or two before she got sick. Much improved. She's still in ICU at St. Agnes Hospital, but much improved. She was awake. She was not in a coma anymore, very responsive. So we are grateful for the improvements there. And then continue to pray for Mikey and Mary, who both moved into care facilities this past week, hoping to get stronger so they can both be home for the holidays. That would be a wonderful goal for both of them. So continue to pray for others who are going through various treatments in our congregation. They would appreciate that very, very much. Well, we're going to receive our morning tithes and offerings. So, gentlemen, if you would come, please, or ladies, whoever is waiting on us today. Thank you, men. And our offertory today is provided by our Children's Christmas Choir, all right? And under the direction of Randy Berger and our Children's Ministry Coordinator, Jennifer. And so we are so grateful for them. And all of our kids are going to come in so they can watch, all right? So come on in, guys. We'll give you a chance to get in and get seated. Come on in. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, thanks for life. And thanks for sharing your life with us. Thank you for this season called Christmas. It's celebrated for one reason and one reason alone, and that is because God the Son was born in a little town called Bethlehem and brought joy to the world. Thank you for the opportunity to celebrate this season, and thank you for our kids who've been working for a couple of months just to sing for us today. Thank you that in the simplicity of their hearts, they believe the message of the music they will share with us. Father, your scripture says, unless we can become like little children with simplicity of heart, by faith, we cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So I pray that all of us will be taken into our childhood days for a few minutes today with clarity of thought, simply express our trust in you. For the privilege of giving and sharing, we say thanks.
Yes.
It is the season for our hearts to be generous. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let me pause just briefly before I jump into the sermon and make a brief commercial. It's Christmas time, we're looking for gifts. A lot of folks like to give books. We talked about a couple recently, we had them available out here. These are not available here today. You need to go to the Majesty to pick them up. I've read both of these books just this year. One of them has made my top 10, or top 12. Both of them could have, but there's a lot of similarities, so I just picked one of them, all right? But they're kind of biographical, but yet loaded with stories, real life stories of this young woman. Her name is Christine Hamish. She is she's an Aussie. She's from down under. God has done some incredible work in her life. He's now doing some incredible work through her life. And the first one is called Unstoppable, Running the Race You Were Born to Win. In Unstoppable, Christine Kane enthralls us with the true stories and eternal principles that inspire us to run the race of our life. Receiving the baton of faith in sync with our team, the body of Christ. And that goes with today's sermon, Spiritual Gifts, Running Together as a Team. Your race is now. This is your moment. When you run with God in his divine relay, you can't lose. You are running the race you were born to win. And it's time to run in a new way. It's time to realize you're unstoppable. What a good book. I actually read the second one first. I had never heard of her. I was in Madison one day, and Harry handed me a galley copy of a book that was going to be published in 4 or 5 months. And he said, I was asked to read this and to write a review for it. He said, I don't have time to read it. And so he handed it to me. I read it on the flight to Africa. And I read it twice before I got back from Africa. It's just an incredible book. Daring to do what God calls you to do. Christine offers life-transforming insights about not only how to overcome the trials and the wrong turns and often painful circumstances we all experience, but also how to grow from these experiences, be equipped and empowered to help others. And just two very, very good books. Men, I know this is kind of biographical about a woman. Anything other than Sports Illustrated is a big read for you sometimes. Hardly recommend both of these, all right, to guys as well as gals. Two great, great books that I find very, very rewarding. So, commercial folder. How many of you read chapter 17 and believed this week? Good job! All right, not bad. If you're visiting with us today and you're wondering, what are you talking about? We are in the midst of a 30-week Bible sermon series called Believe. It's divided into 3 groups of 10. The first 10 weeks we looked at those things we need to think about. What are the 10 key truths of the Bible that we should build our life on? It's essential for us to have eternal life and to have the life that God calls us to in this world. 10 key truths. We're now in the middle of the 10 key practices. If we believe these 10 key truths, how should those truths impact the choices we make and the way in which we live? How do we put into practice what we believe? And then last of all, the last 10 weeks, we will look, once we know what we believe and we've acted on what we believe, God, by his presence in us, will produce his character. So what are the 10 key characteristics of God that will be evident in our lives as a result of knowing the truth and practicing the truth and let it be revealed in us? So we are in the middle of that. We're doing this study together. Randy Frazee put together a Bible in a different format. It's organized according to these 30 subjects. And so most of our church family, you'll find it in the pew in front of you. If you're a visitor and you want to take the one that's in the pew in front of you. All right, that will be okay. I don't even know if we have any more out there. Do we have any Believe Bibles still?
Yeah.
We do have a few. All right, so there's some out there. The price is $10, $5, or $3. You choose the price. Don't you wish you could buy all your Christmas gifts that way? Awesome. But anyway, we'd love for you to have one, and so everybody tries to read along with the series. Today, I find it interesting. Next Sunday and the following Sunday, we take a break. All right, so give me a heads up. We will break from our series for the next two Sundays, for Christmas Sunday and the last Sunday of the year. We'll be back on track the first Sunday of 2015. I find it interesting that we stop today, and the subject is spiritual gifts. What are you guys doing a lot of this week? You are buying gifts to give, all right? So I find it interesting. So we're going to try to tie these two concepts together, the gifts of the Christmas season to the spiritual gifts that God gives to us as his children. May I add, is anybody in here who knows how to turn those two sets of lights off? No, the ones that are in here. These, Randy may have left us. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. Got them. They're done. They're off. Yeah, I blame them. Okay. Let's get started. A man from Illinois. Do we have anybody here from Illinois? Okay, got one of you. Okay, good. That one's a woman. Okay. But this is a man from Illinois decided to travel to Wisconsin. Anybody from Wisconsin here? Okay, yeah, they don't want to let you out of state. But a man from Illinois decided to travel to Wisconsin to go duck hunting. He shot and dropped a bird, but it fell into a farmer's field on the other side of the fence. As the flatlander climbed over the fence, the farmer drove up on his tractor and said, "Hey, what's going on?" And the hunter said, "I shot a duck and I'm retrieving it." The old farmer replied, "This is my property and you're not coming here." Well, this made the hunter mad. So he said, "If you don't let me cross this fence, I'll call my Chicago lawyer and I'll sue you." The farmer smiled and said, "Apparently, you don't know how we do things here. We settled disagreements with the Wisconsin free kick rule. I'll kick you three times, you kick me three times, and we'll go back and forth until one of us gives up." Well, the Illini liked his challenge because he thought he could easily whip this old farmer. So the Wisconsin Badger climbed off his tractor, planted the steel toe of his heavy work boot in the man's shins. The man buckled to his knees. His second kick went directly to the stomach, knocking the wind out of him. And the farmer landed the third kick on the side of his head. This disoriented man slowly got up. And he said, "Okay, you old codger, it's my turn." To which the farmer responded, "Nah, I give up. You can have to go." Pretty smart old farmer, huh? Many of us battle over things as well, just like these two guys did. Sometimes we fight about things because of a lack of information. Other times we kick people simply because we want to. Most of us, frequently in life, if we're not thoughtful, we will fall back to default mode, to selfish settings, instead of looking at ways to put others first. Remember, Jesus said there are two commands that all the truths of God hang on. Love the Lord your God with all that you got, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. The default mode that most of us have is to start with love yourself and bypass God and our neighbor. And this topic that we're going to look at today, spiritual gifts, probably inside the walls of the church, the fellowship, there's probably not been a bigger battlefield since the first century than this subject of what are and who's got what spiritual gift. I know that because Paul wrote two letters to a church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians. And in both of those letters, he addresses part of this battle that was already going on at that time. You see, we can become prideful about our gifts. We can become boastful about the gifts that God has given to us. We can begin to look down our nose, possibly, at others who don't have the gift that we have or don't exercise it the way in which we do. You see, we can become quick to pick fights to those who are wired differently than we are. Today, what I hope to do is to look at God's spiritual gifts with two key thoughts in mind. The first idea ties us to this season, it's called Christmas. And that is, we want to look at the gift of Christ's birth into our world. And the second idea is hinged on the first idea. Once we have received the gift that was made available to us by the birth of Christ into the world, then we're going to look at the gifts that are now given to us because of Christ's birth in me. The first gift, Christ's birth in the world. The next gifts, as a result of Christ's birth in me. So let's jump in. Number one, God's gift to the world that must be accepted personally by you and me. It was a gift made available to all the world, but it's accepted individually. I can't accept it for you, you can't accept it for me, I can't accept it for my kids, they can't accept it for their kids. Each one of us must accept this gift on our own. How many of you have already been Christmas shopping? You've already been out there in the fray. You've been buying gifts, all right? You probably made your list, right? All right, you know, Santa says, make your list, check it twice, all right? You've been doing that. Now, probably not only did you have a list of names, but you probably, if you had the gift of administration, you probably began to put thoughts about the gift for each person. How much am I going to spend, and what's their interest? And so you get really carried away. Why? Because for a lot of folks, you are interested in getting just the right gift. But different people have different ways of evaluating the rightness of a gift. Okay? Let me illustrate how different people have different ways. 30-some-odd years ago, father-in-law was Ted Watson. He paid to have his front yard mowed. But his wife did the backyard. And it was partly by her choice, okay? Not that he was being a tightwad, but she kind of like. So, for their anniversary one year, he bought her a new push lawnmower. He thought that was a great and right gift. She didn't think so. But Ted learned. The next year, he did not give her a lawnmower. He got her a wheelbarrow. Needless to say, he finally learned he should not buy lawn equipment for anniversary presents. And see, what makes the gift right is not only right in terms of the giver, but also right in terms of the receiver. And we have different views. Here are just a few thoughts about what makes the right gift. First, some people believe the right gift comes with the financial value that is associated with it. That is, the more financially valuable the gift is, the closer it moves into the category of being right. Do you know folks like that? That you've got to make a point to spend more? Who cares if it's a crappy gift? As long as it had a big price tag, that is... Did I just say crappy out loud? Bad gift. It's okay, but... In fact, for those folks, you intentionally leave the original price tag on it. Second, others believe that the gift is right if it meets the particular need of the recipient. So the most expensive gift may not be the right gift at all because it does not meet the need. And the inexpensive gift may be the right one because it does meet the need of a person. Third, a gift is considered right if it is wrapped with pure, unadulterated motive in the heart of the giver. Man, deals with motive. Why are you giving this gift to that person? Now, to illustrate how sometimes you can give a large and expensive gift, and we know it's not right because the motive is wrong, is a story out of history. And I don't have time to retell the story, and I've realized history in school is not taught the same way it was when I was in school. So some of the things that I learned in school, our kids, grandkids, are not learning them, all right? So the story of the Trojan horse, how many of you know that story? Okay, how many of you don't know that story? Raise your hands. Okay, we have, okay, don't know, okay, yeah, all right, yeah, who's don't, okay. You can Google it, because I don't have time to tell you. But be sure you put in horse after Trojan, okay? I want to clarify. We got good ones. Clarify, all right? because it could take you directions you had no intention of going, all right? But in that story, in spite of the financial value and the gigantic size of that horse, this was not a gift at all, because the motive for why it was given was very deceptive. Some time ago, a story goes that a man punished his 3-year-old daughter for wasting a roll of gold wrapping paper. Money was tight. He thought she was wasting it. He became infuriated as his child tried to decorate a box to put under the Christmas tree. Nevertheless, in spite of the tirade of her father, the little girl brought the gift to her dad on Christmas morning. She gave it to him. He's now embarrassed by his earlier reaction from the day before. But within seconds, his anger flared again when he unwrapped the box, took the top off the box, and found that it was empty. He yelled at her, telling her there must be something inside the box if it's going to be a gift. And the little girl looked up at him, her lips puckering, her eyes filling with tears, and she said, "Oh, Daddy, the box is not empty. I blew kisses all in the box." We can see from the story, this gift might be an empty box, but the motive behind it is priceless. It may not measure up to the material expectations of our modern mind, but the love that was there is incomparable. So what is it that makes a gift the right gift? When the price is right? To some extent, yes. When it's the right solution for a particular need? Of course, always. And right motive? Definitely. At first glance, weaving these three elements into the right gift, into one pattern, might appear to be easy, but in reality, it's not always that simple. As human beings, we tend to focus on the financial value of a gift rather than on the spiritual aspect of it. So the needs that it meets are often those at the surface rather than those needs which are deeper. Even our motives at best are deceptive, often with grains of selfishness, if not outright boasting. We give because we have to, and we give not because we love to, but we feel obligated to. But the gift of God that He gave to the world 2,000 plus years ago, this does not leave us without the right gift. Rightly understood, the birth and the life and the sacrifice of Jesus offers to you and to me the perfect gift. If we apply the three elements that we have already chatted about in terms of securing a perfect gift, we find that the gift of God in Jesus Christ surpasses every one of our human expectations. For the right price was spent in Jesus, all the treasures of heaven were spent to offer to you and me this wonderful and precious gift of everlasting life. His gift offers the right solution to our deepest problem. Not a surface problem, our deepest problem, our sin and our sin nature and the consequences of our sin. Romans 6:23 says, "The wages of sin is death. The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Regardless of the price tag, everything that we give in this life is temporary. They don't last forever. If you give your loved one a brand new car this holiday, by the way, anybody anticipating one? A few years from now, that car is going to break down. The clothes that you will put under the Christmas tree this year, will one of two things will happen to them. They will either go out of style, they will wear out. Actually, there's three things. Or screen teacher curves. And they don't fit anymore. Everything passes in time. Most of you, if you were here last Sunday afternoon, you know the special gift that I got for my birthday. Some of my buddies went together and got very creative. And they purchased for me a replica of Roy Rogers' cowboy hat. It's awesome. It's incredible. I wore it last Sunday afternoon here. It's beautiful. It's absolutely exquisite. But as wonderful as that Roy Rogers' cowboy hat is, it won't last forever. It cannot accompany me through the valley of the shadow of death. Oh, they can put it in my casket, then it gets smashed. If they choose to cremate me, then it can be burned up and be part of my ashes. But it can't go in there. But the Bible reminds us that God's gift, the gift of His Son, lasts forever. His gift through Jesus is life eternal. No ending, no period to it, forever. Number three, this is also a gift given not out of compulsion. God did not have to. He did not impress anybody by giving this gift. He did it out of a heart of love, the right motive. Jesus Himself said, "For God, my Father, so loved the world that He gave me His one and only Son, that whoever believes in me shall not perish, but have everlasting life." A woman by the name of Ruth Prentice captured this gift of God, and she put it into words. She described it this way. "He did not use a silvery box or paper, green and red. God laid His Christmas gift to men inside a manger bed. No silken cord was used to bind the gift sent from above. It was wrapped in swaddling clothes and bound in cords of tender love. There was no evergreen to which His precious gift was tied. Upon a bare tree on a hill, the gift was hung. And He died. It was taken down from off that tree and laid beneath the sod. But death itself could not destroy the precious gift of God. With mighty hand He lifted Him out of the stony grave, forevermore, to every man, a living gift He gave." God has given us the best gift heaven can offer. And the question is, how have you responded to that gift? Have you accepted it? Have you received it? You see, the whole subject of spiritual gifts has no value unless you will first become the recipient of God's gift to you and me, the gift of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Once you and I have received that gift, then the second observation is of critical importance to us. God's personal gifts to you and me must now be used for the world. God gave His first gift to all the world, and it must be accepted personally. But once we have accepted this personal gift, the gifts that God gives to us now must be shared through us to the rest of the world. Let's talk a little bit about the subject of spiritual gifts. In 1 Corinthians chapters 12 through 14, Paul wanted to make sure that this new church in the first century had a very clear and proper understanding about spiritual gifts, because they were struggling and fighting over them in church. The church at Corinth needed this instruction, and I probably think we do as well. In fact, let me just ask you a question. This is dangerous, because nobody wants to answer these kind of questions. So you're saying, why are you asking me? Humor me. If I were to ask, what is one of your spiritual gifts, how many of you could answer me just like that? Raise your hand. You know your spiritual gift. If I ask that question, how many of you would say, I have absolutely no idea what my spiritual gift is? You can raise your hand. That's okay, because you're going to be in the majority. Okay, come on, put them up. Encourage others. All right. See, I probably need to talk about this more. Okay? Because there's great confusion about it. And sometimes it's not confusion, it's just we have a lack of information. Here's what Paul said to the church in Corinth in verse 1 of chapter 12. He said, "Now about spiritual gifts, I do not want you to be ignorant." I don't want you to be ignorant about this subject of this thing called spiritual gifts. This is a topic that is too important for believers to be uninformed about, and it's certainly too critical for us to fight about. John MacArthur, a pastor in Southern California, says no local congregation will be what it should be until it understands spiritual gifts. So in that arena, I have failed. This is an important subject for us. And one Sunday is probably not enough, but it's all we're going to do in this series. And maybe afterwards we need to spend some time here. So let's define the subject. Let's begin by defining what a spiritual gift is. Bruce Bunkin, who was the former founder of a ministry called Network Ministries, describes it this way, influenced by a lot of different writers. He summarizes it with these words: spiritual gifts are divine abilities distributed by the Holy Spirit to every believer according to God's design and grace for the common good of the body of Christ. Important definition. They are divine abilities. These are not natural talents. We'll talk a little bit about the difference between those in just a moment. Divine abilities distributed by God in the person of the Holy Spirit, because that's how we're saved, when the Holy Spirit comes to live within us. At the moment that we confess our need for a Savior, God sends His presence, the Holy Spirit, to live within our human spirit. And He does it to who? To every believer. That means you don't have any. You have at least one. Not a one of His children has zero. Because He's given some, it says, to every believer, according to God's design. And you can't blame me. You can't blame your spouse. You can't blame anybody else. And He does it for the common good, the body of Christ, and the growth of the kingdom of the world. The difference between spiritual gifts and natural abilities. It's important to recognize that a spiritual gift given to us by God at conversion, whereas a natural talent is something that we were born with. While we were being shaped and formed in our mother's wombs, that DNA going together, all right, was shaping what our natural talents were going to be like. The difference between spiritual gifts and the fruit of the Spirit. Fruit of the Spirit found in the book of Galatians chapter 5. Love, joy, peace, goodness, gentleness, patience, kindness. Okay? The fruit of the Spirit. Every single one of those listings under the fruit of the Spirit ought to be developing in every one of our lives as a child of God. It'll be at different levels, different phases, different production quantities in each of us based upon our trust, dependence, and growth in Christ. But every one of the fruit of the Spirit ought to be reflected in us. Nobody should not be kind. Nobody should not be loving. Nobody should not be patient. Now, some of you are more patient than others, like my dad. Dad tells me patience is his middle name. None of his family believes that, but it's okay. It's in growing measure in all of us, different times. So the fruit of the Spirit is something that should be in all of us, but all the spiritual gifts will not be in one of us. And we'll come back to that in a moment. All of the spiritual gifts will not be in one of us. We're going to have different ones functioning in us, and we'll come back to that in a moment. Distinct categories. While there are many ways to categorize the gifts of the Spirit, I like the simplicity of one suggested by Chuck Swindoll, former pastor of Fullerton EV Free Church. And again, I'm showing my age. This is a guy who was known around the world in the 80s, late 70s and 80s. He's been the president of Dallas Theological Seminary. He's planted a church in Texas as well as the one that he pastored in Fullerton. Brilliant guy, great speaker, and a prolific author. And he's done a nice job of kind of organizing the gifts of the Spirit for, out of four passages of the Bible, kind of organizing them for. So I'm going to use his thoughts for a simple explanation today. Based on 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11, there are two primary areas of distinction of spiritual gifts. One is speaking and the other is serving. The third category could include what's known as the sign gifts, which may be temporary in nature. Based on 2 Corinthians 12:12, that says these gifts were given to the apostles and were critical to the church when there was a young church, when there was not a Bible to test what was right or wrong, you could verify whether an apostle was an apostle of God or a false prophet by the signs. The signs were wonders and miracles that were done with great perseverance. These gifts were important in that first century church. 1 Corinthians 13:8 suggests many of these kinds of gifts may cease to function. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. So let's summarize all that quickly. Speaking gifts. People who have the various gifts of wisdom, of prophecy, of evangelism, of pastoring and teaching. Service gifts. Administration. You don't find that listed in the fruit of the Spirit. Just quick, how many of you would say you have the gift of administration? This comes naturally to you. Okay, got a hand there, got a hand there, got a hand there. Yeah, good. I don't have that one. Okay? Because administration, you kind of got to bird dog people. Okay? I like to tell them once and then I get ticked. Okay? And that's not a good gift of administration. Okay? But there are some who are very organized, very structured, and those of us who aren't need people who are good at administration. It's very, very helpful, but not everybody has it. Think what the world would be like if everybody had the gift of administration. You're talking about a control freak world, okay? Everybody trying to do that. And then there's exhortation. Well, look, if everybody had the gift of exhortation, then we'd all be yelling at each other all the time. And then there are other gifts listed under service gifts: faith, giving, helps, serving, mercy. And let me pause for just a moment. Some of these gifts may not be the gift given to you by the Holy Spirit, but that doesn't mean you're not engaged in that activity. Does that make sense? Okay, let me explain it. It made reference to the gift of faith. Should only the people who've been given the gift of faith have faith? No, everyone who becomes a child of God has faith, because you don't become a child of God without it. Okay? But there are some, according to this passage, who have been given the gift of faith. In other words, you are going to see faith exercised in and through them in ways that you don't see through the general family of God. This is just a gift. For some reason, their heart bends that direction. Far from you. The gift of serving others. Does that mean none of us should serve anybody else unless we have the gift of serving? No, by all means not. We're going to be engaged. It may not be our gift, but there's still some of that activity. Giving. Only folks, because nobody's going to want the gift of giving. If you only give, you've been given a gift. No. Well, the Bible says God loves a cheerful giver. Okay? And that's a general comment to all of us, but there are some who are naturally gifted. They just can't give enough away. And it comes very natural and easy for them. And then things like serving and mercy. And then there are assigned gifts, that third area, distinguishing, the ability to distinguish evil spirits. We saw the prophets, the apostles do that in the New Testament. The gift of performing miracles and healings and tongues and interpretation. And that's where most of the issues of disagreement within the church come in. And we don't have time to go there today, all right? The description of these gifts. If you were to add up all the distinct spiritual gifts in all three of these groups, you'd come up with about 20. Since each of these lists do not appear to be identical to each of these four passages, not one of these lists appear to be exhaustive, so that there's a good possibility there's even other gifts than what's just listed here. But these groups are found in four passages: Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians 4, and 1 Peter 4. And they're listed there to provide help and influence for God's kingdom work. The distribution of these gifts. As we study this subject of spiritual gifts, it's important to keep in mind that we are commanded to do much more of the things that are listed also as spiritual gifts. And I've already mentioned that. Let me ask you a question. I want to talk to you about natural talent and spiritual gifts for a moment. See if I can illustrate the difference there. How many of you heard Billy Graham preach? Okay? How many of you would say that Billy Graham has preached the greatest sermons you've ever heard in your life? That's about what I expected. Okay? Two or three. And that probably, if I were to probe a little bit, is because you feel bad by not saying that it wasn't one of the greatest sermons you've ever heard. But in terms of just a great sermon, Billy Graham has not preached some of the best sermons I've ever heard in my life. But Billy Graham exercises the gift that God gave to him. Graham had a natural talent to speak. Natural talent is not enough. Okay? Zig Ziglar would be a better public speaker than Billy Graham would be. Natural gift. Okay? Natural talent, I should say. But what Billy Graham has, he has the gift of evangelism. And that's the reason that Billy Graham can preach the same sermon 40, 50, 60 times in different parts of the world, and hundreds of people respond, because he is exercising the gift that God had given to him. That make sense?
Yeah.
I've known people that start music. I've known people who are really talented musically. In music, you have natural talent. You have trained musicians. And often, trained musicians will have a certain degree of natural talent. But I've met some folks okay, who are great musicians, but they can't carry a tune in the bucket, and they can't do anything unless they've got music right in front of them. So you've got natural talent, you've got trained, and those go together, and then you also have gifted, spiritually gifted. I have a dear friend, his name is Bruce Wood, some of you know him. Bruce Wood has some natural talent. He's the kind of guy that he sits down at the piano, and you say, "Do you know this song?" And he'll say, "No, but just start singing." And if you start singing, he'll all of a sudden, with one hand, start playing. And then the second time, too, he'll add the fill hand. And by the third time, he'll be dressing it up. Now, I have heard other musicians who are better trained, maybe better talented than he is. But when Bruce sits down at the piano and leads worship, his gravelly voice and his skill on a piano is not his talent or his training. It is the giftedness of God in his life. And he engages others to come and participate and exalt the Lord and use it. So you can be talented, and you can be trained, and also you can be either one of those, and you can be gifted. There's a difference. Romans chapter 12, verses 4 through 6 says it this way. I'm doing good. For just as each one, we are one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so Christ in us, though many, we form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. When we made the courageous decision to accept Jesus Christ in this light of faith and embrace Him for our personal Savior, the Holy Spirit placed in us, every one of us, a gift and or gifts. They are offered out of God's treasury of righteous qualities. We do not have to ask Him, He gives them. When the Creator forms us, He molds and shapes our personality, and these are our talents. When we are born again, He repurposes our innate talents that He created a person of birth, and He wants us to use them for the purpose of His church. But it's also true that God deposits a spiritual gift in a person that takes up residence in our life. And this gift may have nothing to do with our talent, but it has a special uniqueness to our personality, and God wants to use it for an eternal purpose. Because Antonio's voice is kind of high and squeaky, he did not make the tryouts for the Cremona Voice Choir. When he took violin lessons, the neighbors persuaded his parents to make him stop. Yet Antonio still wanted to make music. His friends gave him a hard time because his only talent that was obvious to others was whittling wood. When Antonio was older, he served as an apprentice to a violin maker. His knack for whittling grew into a skill of carving, and his hobby became his craft. He worked patiently and faithfully, and by the time that he died, he left 1,500 violins, each one bearing a label that read, Antonio Stradivarius. Y'all know your history. They, I've been told, are the most sought-after violins in the world, and they will sell from $100,000 up. Antonio couldn't sing or play or preach or teach, but his responsibility was to use a gift. And his violins are still making beautiful music today. Key question, what gifts and abilities has God given to you, to me, to serve others? How can we know our gifts? Let me see if I can help with that by telling you a story. Imagine that driving down the freeway. In front of your vehicle is a pickup truck with a family of five inside. It's a double cab. In the back of the truck are a number of cages filled with chickens. The truck suddenly begins to swerve. It's out of control. It runs off the road into the ditch and it flips over. The cages fly out the back and break open. And all the chickens are released. You, along with a number of others, immediately pull off the shoulder to try to help. Now I want you to think, what would be your first response to the activity you most likely would engage in as you stop and assist in the scene? Are you the person who would immediately take charge? You would announce to everybody else there, "Hey, I got this figured out, folks. Leave it to me and listen up." And you begin delegating responsibilities, giving orders to bystanders, putting them into action. Are you the person who would begin to organize and oversee the details of the guy who's telling everybody what to do? After hearing the orders from the leader, you implement a plan. You divide people into groups, distribute equipment, somebody directs traffic, those who can assist the victims, those who would be the ticket regulators. You then make sure those groups have the necessary tools to get the job done. Are you the person who would focus completely on the needs of the people in the truck? Forget the truck, forget the chickens, they can wait. You go straight to the five people in the vehicle to offer them assistance, put them at ease, care for them until paramedics arrive. Sense of mercy for the victims is your primary force. Or are you the person who quickly realizes this effort is going to take a while? The rescue team is going to need food and water, so you take off to get some supplies. You need to be hospitable to those who are sacrificing time and energy for the service of others. Are you the person who would begin to ask the people around the accident that everyone might learn from this unfortunate situation? What could have been done to avoid this accident? How could it be prevented in the future? What steps can the highway department take to avoid problems like this in this location? You gather intel to teach others to avoid the same thing in the future. Are you the person who simply walks up and says, hey, give me something to do, put me to work, whatever you need, I'll do it. And then you're the one who stays and does the dirty work until the victims are gone to the hospital, every chicken's been recaged. Before you leave, you even pick up the debris from the accident, and you're the last one to follow the tow truck off the site. Do you see the different gifts that are engaged right there, actions taken to help with one problem? The role you see yourself taking in this setting can indicate a great deal about the spiritual gift that God has given you. As in the case of those on the scene of this hypothetical accident, your gift has not been given for your own personal benefit, but rather it's to be used to serve in concert with other members of the body of Christ. So the key idea, I know my spiritual gifts and I use them to fulfill God's purposes. Just reflect quickly on this accident scenario again. I listed six gifting possibilities. What if a person demanded each gift to stop to help? What if six people had shown up, each representing one of those gifts? Everything involved in the accident, the victims, the chickens, the truck, the traffic, everything would be covered. Therein lies God's intentions for us to meet the needs on earth. We work together for His glory. When you become a member of the body of Christ, you join a community of people who are under the authority and the guidance of God Himself. The contribution of your gift that God has given you will accomplish His purposes for the advancement of His kingdom and the welfare of others. In the letter to the Romans, Paul said, by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith that God has distributed to you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each belongs to the other. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy to your faith. If it's serving, then serve. If it's teaching, then teach. If it's encouragement, give encouragement. If it's giving, give generously. If it's to lead, do it diligently. If it's to show mercy, then show mercy cheerfully. Our spiritual gifts are to be practiced out of a heart filled with grace, humility, and faith. We are commissioned to discover what God has gifted us with and to use it for His glory. Key application. What difference does this make in the way in which we live today? One, we should seek to serve using the gift that God has given us so one, we can glorify Him and help others around us. Two, we should value and respect the gift that God has given to others as we serve together in God's purposes. Number three, we come to see that using our gifts for God gives us a purpose bigger than ourselves. As with biblical community that we looked at last week, spiritual gifts strongly affect our relationship with God and our relationship with others. Let's address our gifts' impacts on others. First question, why would God only give us one or two or maybe three gifts rather than giving one person all the gifts? If I had all the gifts, why would I need two? If you had all the gifts, why would you need anything else? See, not one of us has all the gifts because, remember, God illustrates community in eternity. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Three, yet one. God wants that reflected in us in this world today. It connects us back to biblical community. We're not to live this life in isolation, but in fellowship, relying on each other, cooperating with each other. Our limitations and gifts creates a need for interdependence, for our brothers and sisters to share with the community their gifts, as well as to keep us humble because we cannot reach the world alone. So the fact that I might have the best voice in the choir, the fact that I might be the best preacher, the fact that I might have more money with a heart that gives, doesn't mean I only do it so it showcases my giftedness. But we engage so that we can help with those who don't have the gift. Or so we can cooperate with other gifts so we can greater accomplish the purpose of God in the world. As a seeking, hurting world watches us cooperate and move in unison together to meet needs, they will be drawn to want to experience a life-changing power of shunning the every man for himself attitude and embrace the every soul matters mission of Jesus. We clearly see this interaction in Paul's words to the Corinthian church when he says, what after all, or who after all is Apollos? And who the heck is Paul? We are only servants through whom you have come to believe in God. As the Lord has assigned each of us a task, I planted some seed and Apollos watered some seed, but the end result is what God did. Over 20 years ago, when Saddleback Church in Southern California, we're probably now talking 28 years ago, when Saddleback Church in Southern California had grown to about 500 people, now it's over 20,000 people. Meet there on Sunday. Rick Warren, the senior pastor in morning message, said, folks, I'm out of energy, and the church is getting so big, I can't do much more. And as I read the Bible, it doesn't say I'm supposed to do more. So I'll make you a deal. If you'll do the ministry God's gifted you to do, then I'll do my part, which is to make sure you are well fed by the teaching and the preaching that goes on here. Warren then asked his congregation to shake hands together and make this pact. And it was after that the church was exploding with growth. I don't know what size we'd like New Hope to be, and that's really never been important. But I wonder if you and I can make a pact over the next few weeks. Will you begin to pray and ask God to reveal to you what your spiritual gift and gifts are? And once you know what they are, will you use them in the fellowship of His church? Your staff here will see that you get well fed from the pulpit and through the small groups and the teaching ministries. You make a pact that you will do yours, we'll do ours, and let's see how God wants to change our part of the world through us. Can we make that deal? Can we shake hands on that? If you want to gain a better understanding of your spiritual gift or gifts, there's a great book out there written by a former pastor in Fresno called Discovering Your Spiritual Gift. You might have to Google that one. Might be out of print. It's a good one. Study the scriptures on it. The easiest way that you can probably figure it out, find three good friends who love the Lord. Tell them that story of the truck accident. And ask them, where do they see you plugging in that situation? They'll probably be able to pinpoint your gift. We often want gifts that we don't have. I want to sing. Until heaven, it ain't never going to happen. And I've had plenty of good friends tell me it's not my gift. It's not my gift. But when we are children, most of us pretend to be somebody in a dream. Any of you men around my age, did you ever get a red towel tied around your neck? Any of you ever do that? Come on, it's okay, you can do that. All right, yeah, all right, that's another thing. Play Superman, okay? Anybody jump off the roof? I never went that far. All right. But we dreamed that we could be Superman. I want you to dream about what gift God has given to you. when it is used in through your personality, your intellect, your talent, and energized by the Holy Spirit, God will produce incredible results far above what you can hope, ask, or imagine. And if you don't get to that point in life, you will shortchange yourself in this world. Can we shake hands on it? Let's pray. Our Father, you're an incredibly creative God. And you put some of that creativity in each and every one of us to exercise in the form of the spiritual life. May we not say anymore, I'm not talented. But Father, may we pray for clarity of what is the gift you've given to me. For your word says every person it has been given to. And some may have lost theirs because of disobedience. But Father, you are a gracious God. And as your children, we admit our sin, you restore. So Father, I pray for those of you who are part of your church family, that over these next few weeks, as they approach the end of this year, they will discover what gift you've given them. And Father, if there are those in the service right now who have never received your Son, the Lord Jesus, as the gift of all gifts, I pray they will delay not one second more to say, it's time that I gave my life. And receive the gift of salvation for the brother. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Start saying Merry Christmas a lot.
Knock yourself out.